If you're wanting to watch a video about a case that has all of the answers laid out right in front of you, this is probably not the case for you. Hello everybody, welcome back to my channel. If you are new to my channel, hello, my name is Gabby and welcome. If you've never been here before, have no idea what I do here on my channel, I cover true crime cases. All of the cases that I cover are more on the vintage side. They're all basically 20 years or older. So if that's something you might be interested in, maybe go down below, click that subscribe button and stay a while. If you do end up enjoying my content, make sure to go down below and click that bell notification to be notified every time that I upload, because my uploading schedule is all over the place. The case that I'm going to be talking about today, I heard about 2 years ago. And at the time I wasn't able to speak to anyone about the case. So I kind of put it to the side. I decided to dive into the case again a couple weeks ago, and I was finally able to get in touch with someone very close to the family. This person helped me so much and sent me over about 50 pages of police reports, notes, and scanned documents about this case. A lot of what I'm going to share in this video is very different from what can be found online about this case. Most of my information is coming directly from those documents that I was sent over. When I say this, I do not say it lightly. This is the overwhelmingly tragic story of Mindy Chambers. In the later part of 1982, Mindy was a 17-year-old girl living in Tempe, Maricopa, Arizona with her stepmother, Patricia, and three half-siblings. She had been attending Mount View High School, but dropped out of school in November of 1981 during her junior year. She was a tiny girl standing at only 4 feet 10 inches tall and weighing about 86 pounds according to her ID. On Tuesday, October 19th, 1982, according to Mindy's stepmother, she took two of the children off to their school, and Mindy was set to take the third to their school. Mindy reassured her stepmother that she would be home when she got home from work. Mindy left the apartment at 2141 East University Drive, walking her younger half-sibling to elementary school, which was not a very long walk at all. It was less than 10 minutes. When her younger half-sister, Misty, arrived home from school that day, things seemed off from the start. For one, the front door of the apartment was left open. Nothing in the apartment was out of order or in disarray from what I read, but Mindy was nowhere to be found. And it seemed like all of Mindy's personal belongings were left behind. The last known person to have seen Mindy was the clerk at the Circle K gas station around the corner on the day Mindy went missing. I'm not entirely sure what time this was though. The Circle K gas station was about a 5-minute walk from the apartment in the other direction of the school. The clerk was a friend of Mindy's stepmother's and said that he remembered Mindy coming to the station to use the payphone. Mindy was last seen wearing blue jeans, a t-shirt, and tennis shoes. The clerk said that he saw someone driving a green and tan station wagon drive into the parking lot, grab Mindy, shove her into the vehicle, and drive off. This is the last known sighting of her, and this is where Mindy's case begins. I just wanted to show you all very quickly the distance between the apartments where Mindy was staying with her stepmother and three half-siblings. This is the apartment buildings right here. I also wanted to show you all the distance between the apartment building and the school. It was not very far at all. It was about a 7 to 10 minute walk south, depending, of course, how fast you're walking. And now the distance between the apartment building and the gas station, which was about a 5-minute walk. The first layer of Mindy's disappearance is very cut and dry. She left the home, walked to the gas station payphone, used it, and was obviously taken by somebody, never to be seen again. But it's the layers below that first layer that make her case what it is. So let's begin to dive into those deeper layers right now. And trust me, it's a deep dive. We'll start with Mindy's backstory. Mindy Chambers was born on May 28th, 1965 to parents Mary Zenos and Alan Thomas Chambers in New York. I also wanted to quickly break down Mindy's family tree because there are quite a few characters involved in the story of Mindy's disappearance, and I just wanted to kind of show their relation to Mindy so the story is less confusing for all of my viewers. There is Mindy herself, and then there is her two biological parents, which is her mother, Mary Zenos, and then her father, Alan Chambers. Mindy's three aunts are very involved in Mindy's case, and that is Mindy's mother's two sisters, Stephanie and also Callie. And then there is Mindy's aunt on her father's side, Karen. Mindy's parents married in March of 1964, a year before Mindy was born. Mindy, though, did not know her mother growing up because a few weeks before Mindy turned 3 years old, her mother's life ended in a very tragic and mysterious way. And I say mysterious, but after I go into the details surrounding it, it's pretty obvious what actually happened. On May 7th, 1968, what was actually her 24th birthday, Mary Zenos Chambers was found dead in the family's bathtub at their residence of 26 Roland Street in Yonkers, New York. The cause of death was drowning, even though her body had very noticeable bruising on it. She was found by her husband, Mindy's father, who was 28 at the time, at around 2:30 p.m. that Tuesday, and the medical examiners determined she had most likely been in the bathtub a few hours before she was found, if she really was found at the time her husband said she was. When Mindy's father, Alan Chambers, was asked about where he was for the day, he said it was his only day off during the week from his job as a salesman. He claimed he left the home with their daughter Mindy at around 11:30 a.m. And when he arrived home at around 2:30 p.m., he said that he found Mary in the bathtub, dead, and that he immediately phoned authorities. Authorities believed that Alan had something to do with his wife's death, but they were never able to charge him due to lack of evidence. Richie Smith, the then husband of Mindy's aunt Callie Smith, said, "Alan appeared on my doorstep that day he found Mary. He had scratches on his face and arms, yet he was never brought up on charges. They said they had no evidence." They claimed there was a lack of evidence, yet Mindy's mother had bruising on her body, and her husband, who found her, had scratches on his face and arms. 2 years after the incident, Richie Smith began working as an officer, and he said that Alan Chambers had a very lengthy rap sheet with the Yonkers Police Department. They buried Mindy's mother in Mount Hope Cemetery in Westchester County, New York, and nothing else came of her unusual death. People had a feeling that Alan had something to do with it, but they said without any actual proof, there was nothing they could do. Only within time would Alan himself prove he would have been capable of such a thing. I read in the document sent over to me that before Mary died, she told her sister, Callie Smith, she was wanting to take Mindy and leave Alan, but she knew if she ever left him, that he would kill her. This wasn't her just being paranoid. According to Mary, Alan actually told her that if she ever left him, he would end her life. Callie also stated that after Mary's death, she remembers herself that Alan had scratches and bite marks on him. Callie had a feeling it was Alan who killed her sister, and because of that, she wanted to gain custody of Mindy. Callie and her husband, Richie, wanted to take Mindy in and save her from this horrible man. But within no time, Alan left New York and moved Mindy to Arizona, where his mother lived. Not much time passed before Alan would be behind bars for an unrelated prior charge from when he was living in New York. He was sent to prison for assault and attempted rape. During this time, as he sat in prison in New York, he was sent back there, Mindy was sent to live with Alan's mother, Irene, in Chandler, Arizona. After Irene passed away on February 15, 1972, Mindy was then sent to live with her aunt, Alan's sister, Karen Brower, in Phoenix, Arizona. Karen claimed that Mindy was a great girl and that Mindy and her daughter Cassie were inseparable. Mindy was very happy living with Karen and her family and would have most likely had a healthy upbringing if she stayed there. During that same year of 1972, though, Alan was released from prison. At this time, Mindy was 7 years old, and Alan demanded that he got custody back. Since he was Mindy's biological parent and served his time, there was really nothing any of the family could do, and Karen had to hand Mindy over to him. After this, Alan became extremely controlling of Mindy and wouldn't really let any of her family see her. All contact between Mindy and family was pretty much cut off. I read in the documents sent over to me that one of the few people allowed to see Mindy was Mindy's aunt, Mary's other sister, Stephanie First. In the year 1973, a year after being released from prison, Alan went on to marry a woman named Patricia Ann Locke, also known as the woman who Mindy was staying with when she vanished. Patricia and Alan would end up having 3 children together: Misty, Aleka, and Alan, named after his father. In 1982, the year that Mindy went missing, Patricia was in the process of getting a divorce from Alan, and that's why she was living separately from him at the time. You're all probably wondering, why in 1982 was Mindy living with her stepmother Patricia and not her biological father, Alan? Well, everything is going to start making a lot of sense right about now. Only days before Mindy vanished, she went to authorities with the help of her stepmother and her stepmother's parents, and she told authorities that Alan had been molesting her, and he had been for about 5 years since she was around the age of 12. Records show that after Mindy told this to authorities, she was immediately placed in the protective care of her stepmother. The night before she went missing, Mindy was actually at Patricia's parents' home on the 18th, speaking to police about what Alan had been doing to her for all those years. But when she was speaking to police, she did tell them that she did not want to testify in court against her father. I do want to say that this is not the first time in Mindy's story that these accusations of molestation against Alan came up. Now, as I stated before, Alan's mother, Irene, passed away in 1972. After Irene passed away, Alan's stepfather, Floyd E. Jarrell, remarried a woman named Anne. In 1978, Stephanie First received a phone call from Anne, and Anne asked her if she could come to Arizona and that it's very important. When Stephanie came to visit, she stayed with Mr. and Mrs. Jarrell. During this visit, Anne Jarrell tells Stephanie that she thinks Alan is molesting Mindy. This was 4 years before Mindy went to police about it. Mindy would have been about 13 at the time. Stephanie stated in a police report that during the time she saw Mindy, Mindy told her unsettling things. Mindy told her Aunt Stephanie that Alan never wanted boys over the home, and that Alan would on occasion tell his own daughter that she looked better than his wife Patricia. Stephanie confronted Alan about these molestation accusations and the things that Mindy told her. Of course, he denied them, and then completely cut off all contact between Mindy and her family on her mother's side. Stephanie absolutely adored her niece. She loved Mindy with her whole heart, so much so that in the year 1980, Stephanie actually moved to Tucson, Arizona to be closer to Mindy, in the hopes also that she would be able to help her niece get away from her father and find out what was going on, and that possibly she could take something into her own hands and just get Mindy out of this horrible situation. But Stephanie's contact with her niece from the year 1980 to 1982, when her niece vanished, was very brief. The main time was during the summer of 1981, when Mindy telephoned Stephanie from a payphone. She told her that Alan and her stepmother Patricia had separated, that they were having some issues, and that she and her father were staying at a motel. Stephanie asked Mindy where this motel was, and Mindy told her that she was forbidden by her father to tell her where it was. This was the last contact that Stephanie ever had with Mindy. So Mindy ends up telling authorities in 1982 that her father is sexually assaulting her, a man suspected of murder, a man who went to prison for the exact thing his daughter is saying that he's doing to her. And then days later, his daughter disappears, and no one has heard from her since. Obviously, all fingers point to Alan Chambers having something to do with it. If those aspects don't do it for you, also remember how the clerk at the Circle K claimed he saw Mindy being forced into a tan and green station wagon. Mindy's half-sister, Misty, stated that at the time of Mindy's disappearance, their father was driving a tan and green station wagon. Mindy's case would unfortunately be at a standstill until 13 years after her disappearance in 1995. During that year, Mindy's aunt, Karen Brower, Alan's sister, learned that Mindy was actually never reported missing. Karen stated in a police report that she started looking for her brother and niece in about 1980 to 1981, which was a year to 2 years before Mindy disappeared, and she could never really find out where they were. She finally got in contact with Alan's ex-wife, Patricia, in the year 1985, because strangely enough, Patricia started working at the same school Karen worked at. Patricia told her that no one had heard of or seen Mindy since she went missing 3 years earlier in 1982. Karen found out Mindy was missing in 1985, but figured that there had been a missing persons report filed for her. It wasn't until 10 years later, in 1995, she discovered that there had never been a missing persons report officially filed for Mindy Chambers, and that's when she immediately went to the department to get one filed. A missing persons report was officially filed for Mindy Chambers on April 17, 1995. According to reports online and the files that I was given at the time, authorities didn't take Mindy's case too seriously, and like so many other stories, they thought that Mindy was simply a runaway. And according to Mindy's aunts, Mindy had ran away in the past. Mindy was in Patricia's care at the time that she went missing, so it would have been Patricia's responsibility to officially file one, but I cannot speak on Patricia's behalf. I was unable to speak to her for this video, so I'm not entirely sure why there was never a missing persons report officially filed for Mindy back in the year of 1982. People thought that possibly Mindy just up and left. Her mother was gone, she didn't have a happy childhood, and she just recently told authorities about what her father was doing to her. One would think she did in fact run away, but due to the fact she brought nothing with her and was forced into a vehicle that looked a great deal like the one her abusive father drove at the time, it doesn't seem likely that she just was a runaway. Something most likely happened to her. Foul play is definitely suspected in this case. According to records, though, Child Protective Services did contact Alan Chambers 6 days after Mindy went missing. They wanted to speak to him about the molestation accusations by his daughter, and he hung up. And that was basically that. He hung up, and they didn't look into the accusations anymore. Years later, they were asked about why they didn't look further into it, and they denied to comment without researching into the case further. We do not know what else could have happened or evolved during those years that Mindy was not in the system as a missing person. Too many times this occurs because a victim is just shrugged off as a runaway. Now, I was given over some of Patricia's personal notes regarding the timeline of events after Mindy disappeared. She stated that the evening after Mindy went missing, she notified authorities about the incident via phone. She waited for Mindy to show up or call. Patricia stated that the end of the week, on Friday or Saturday, Alan dropped by the apartment and asked where Mindy was because he was told she was staying with Patricia. She said that during this visit, Alan wanted Mindy's belongings, but she wouldn't hand them over. On Sunday or Monday, Patricia supposedly brought Mindy's purse, wallet, comb, makeup kit, and clothes to the police department and left them with someone at the front desk. On Tuesday or Wednesday of the next week, she says Alan called and wanted Mindy's belongings. She told him that she had dropped them off at the station, and according to her, Alan got very angry. About 2 or 3 weeks later, Patricia stated that she phoned the Mesa Police Department to see if there had been any word of Mindy. There hadn't been. About 3 or 4 weeks after that, she says she called again, and the department told her they didn't know anything else regarding the case, and they acted like they had no idea about the belongings that Patricia supposedly dropped off there days after Mindy went missing. She stated that 2 or 3 months went by, and she called again, and was informed there wasn't even a file on Mindy's disappearance at all. If what Patricia said is 100% factual, that proves that the police department did not take Mindy's case seriously by any means. When it comes to Mindy's case, she had family members spread throughout the United States. She had family in New York, Arizona, and also Florida. Everyone was a bit disconnected, and of course, some of Mindy's mother's side of the family didn't speak to Mindy's father's side of the family, and vice versa. In the 90s, though, is when members of both sides started coming together and comparing notes regarding Mindy's case. Mindy's Aunt Karen on her father's side and Mindy's Aunt Callie on her mother's side, they came together in about 1994, and they were basically just comparing notes for about 8 to 12 months, seeing what they could come up with and seeing how they could help Mindy's case. Now, on January 10th, 1995, Karen was contacted by Patricia and told that Patricia had just received the news that Alan Chambers had actually died the month before, on December 14th of 94, when he was driving as a truck driver. Alan Chambers was driving on a rain-slicked road in Virginia when he ran off the road. His vehicle overturned and he was thrown from it, and he died instantly. Now, everyone knew that Alan had something to do with Mary's death. They knew that he had something to do with Mindy's disappearance, possible death, but Alan was now dead himself. And even if they were able to take it to court and find out that he was the one responsible, he would never serve time. He was dead. Even though justice would never properly be served, they did not want to give up on Mindy's case. This next bit of information that I'm going to share with you all, my mouth kind of hit the floor. My mind didn't even know how to wrap around it because I was not even entirely sure how somebody would go about faking such a thing or getting such a thing done legally. The day after Karen had found out that Alan had died back the month before, she also found out that an identification card had been issued for Mindy Chambers in April of 1991, 4 years earlier. On this identification card, it stated that the individual's name was Mindy Chambers. Their birthday was May 28th, 1965, which was Mindy's birthday. Their eye color was hazel and their hair was brown. Karen decided that she was going to go to the address on the identification card, which was an address in Oklahoma, and she was going to find out why this individual, whoever it was that lived there, filed an identification card for a missing individual from years earlier. Karen discovered that this residence used to be the home of Alan before he passed away, and it was the current home of Alan's widow and 3 children. Karen also found out that not only was an identification card issued for a Mindy Chambers in April 1991, but also a social security card. Both the ID and social security card were applied for in Shawnee, Oklahoma. The strange thing, though, is that the ID had all the matching information of Mindy Chambers except the height and weight. The ID issued in 1991 stated her height was 5 feet, 4 inches tall, and that her weight was 130 pounds, which is obviously much different than the 4 feet 10 and 86 pounds that Mindy was in 1982 when she vanished. After days of trying, Karen was actually able to get a hold of Alan's widow. This widow was Alan's next wife after he and Patricia divorced. Alan had gotten married to this woman, her name was Diana, and they had 3 daughters together. These daughters would be Mindy's half-siblings. Karen wanted to speak with Diana in person, see if she herself knew anything about Mindy's disappearance, that possibly Alan may have confessed something to her while they were married. Also, Karen wanted to know why there was an ID and social security card filed for Mindy 9 years after she vanished. According to a police report that Karen had filed, Karen said Diana acted quite strange. She wasn't sure if something was wrong with her or if she was just uncomfortable. Karen said she asked Diana if she ever met Alan's oldest daughter, Mindy. And Diana looked her dead in the eyes and said, "Mindy is missing. M-I-S-S-I-N-G. Diana just kept saying Mindy was missing. Now, Diana was acting very strange, but she told her that she never met Mindy or spoke to her, but told Karen that she was more than welcome to look through some of Mindy's belongings that Alan had kept in a box. Some of the items Karen came across in this box were items that were thought to have possibly been in Mindy's possession the day that she went missing. Those items included two Mountain View High School IDs, Mindy's Social Security card, one Western Savings Bank card, one card from Hair Performers, and one Mesa General Hospital card. Karen said, though, that it was her understanding that, according to Patricia, these were items that were not on Mindy the day that she went missing. These were items that Patricia had given over to authorities back in 1982 after Mindy went missing. The reporting investigator, though, found nothing to indicate any items were ever turned over to Mesa police. Was Patricia just mistaken and she thought she had given over these exact items to police so many years earlier? Or did she actually never give any items to police at all? Did she actually give over some items to authorities and they were just misplaced at the police department? Maybe authorities had the items in their possession somewhere on file, and then maybe Mindy's father went to the department, said he was Mindy's father and wanted the belongings back. Were these items that were actually on Mindy's person the day that she went missing and Alan had something to do with her disappearance and he did something to her and kept these belongings? These are all things that we do not know. One thing we do know is that regarding the ID and Social Security card filed for Mindy in 1991, I asked the source that I was speaking to about this, and they informed me that it was later discovered that Alan did make someone close to him use Mindy's information in the attempt to get an ID and Social Security card made. I have to keep that individual's identity private, but it was not Mindy being still alive. It was someone else who came into the picture after Mindy's disappearance, who was very close to Alan. This is just one of those cases that all of the clues, all of the information, all of the evidence points to one person being responsible, but that person is gone, and that is probably the only person that has ever walked the face of the earth besides the victim that knows what happened. There are so many unanswered questions. There are so many different directions that your mind goes down, but all in all, I have to say that if there is one conclusion to this case, it's a very sad one, and that is that Mindy was failed. She was just failed, and I don't mean by everybody in her life, because so many people tried to help her. It's just kind of like life failed her. When it comes to a missing persons case, there's always one main question that people think of, and that is that, has there ever been a Jane or John Doe that could be this individual who is missing? And in this case, yes, there was one Jane Doe that popped up, and many thought that it could have been Mindy Chambers. On January 1st, 1984, 2 years after Mindy disappeared, the partial remains of an unknown girl were found in a pasture in Vidor, Orange County, Texas. Her cause of death is listed as possible decapitation. There are a lot of similarities between this doe and Mindy Chambers. Mindy Chambers was 4 feet 10 inches tall, and this doe was estimated to be between 4 feet 6 inches tall to 5 feet 2 inches tall. Mindy was 17 years old at the time of her disappearance, and this doe was estimated to be between 12 to 20 years of age. Mindy and this doe had similar hair color, but this doe's was cut much shorter at the time she was found and much shorter than depicted in the sketch. Mindy had her braces taken off 2 years before she went missing, and this doe most likely had braces at some time. Mindy went missing in 1982, and this doe's death was determined to be during 1983 or possibly prior. A blue, green, and white Present Company or Penny Company pullover terry cloth short-sleeved shirt with an elastic waistband, size juniors 9 to 12, was found near the remains of the Jane Doe. As for Mindy, we do know that she was wearing jeans, a shirt, and tennis shoes, but I'm not entirely sure the color shirt, if she was possibly wearing a jacket as well, or the color of her tennis shoes. We just know the vague description of what she was wearing that day. When it comes to the sketch, it does bear a bit of a resemblance to Mindy. First, they were going to compare dental records, but strangely, they could not find Mindy's. I say strangely because Mindy had just had her braces taken off 2 years before her disappearance. They should have been able to locate these records somehow, but they couldn't. Then they decided to conduct a DNA test, and they compared DNA of Mindy's half-sister to the DNA of the Jane Doe, and it was not a match. I'm not entirely sure what year this DNA test was conducted, but at the time, authorities stated they would need DNA from a paternal blood relative of Mindy's to be able to tell for sure if this Jane Doe was Mindy Chambers. This is one thing, just as a researcher, that I personally do not understand. I am no expert on deoxyribonucleic acid, aka DNA, but I know that with today's technology, you can compare half siblings' DNA and it will show you if they do have the same amount of DNA that consists with half siblings. Also, maternal relatives, which are female relatives, pass along mitochondrial DNA that withstands over time. Ants are a more than acceptable source of DNA, and Mindy has ants on both her mother and father's side. I am also not entirely sure why they even tested Mindy's half-sister's DNA against the Jane Doe to begin with, if they already determined they insist on Mindy's parents' DNA to verify for sure if she is the Jane Doe or not, but I'm not entirely sure what year this DNA test was done in. It could have been in the early years of DNA testing, so possibly they were just wanting a parent's DNA to 100% make sure. When it comes to testing Mindy's parents' DNA against the Doe's DNA, her mother passed away in 1968, as we know. I am not sure if she was cremated or not, but Mindy's father was cremated. When a lot of people first heard about this Jane Doe in Texas, a lot of people thought that maybe it was Mindy and she was dumped in Texas since her father was a truck driver. Based on my research though, and word straight from my source, at the time of Mindy's disappearance, her father was actually unemployed and was not yet a truck driver. An article that I came across that was posted in 2015 stated that one of Mindy's aunts, which I'm not entirely sure which one it was referring to, that one of her aunts compared their DNA to the DNA of the Jane Doe and that it came back negative. The person that I was talking to, I asked them about this and they said that they had never heard about this. They were not sure if this actually happened, so I'm not entirely sure if this news was factual. I was not, on my part, able to confirm this, but all in all, when it comes to this Jane Doe, pretty much all of Mindy's family members do not believe that this Jane Doe is Mindy. Mindy's aunt, Callie Smith, said, "It's amazing that almost 30 years later, this is so raw. We tried so hard to get her away from him. The man was dangerous. It's still so raw because you feel like you've failed a child." It has been 38 years since Mindy went missing, and this case is honestly no closer to being solved than the day after it happened. Mindy Chambers would be 55 years old in today's time. The photo on the right is an age progression of Mindy Chambers to 47 years old, done by the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children in 2012. If you have any information about the disappearance of Mindy Chambers, you are urged to contact the Mesa Police Department at 480-644-2211. Remember that you can stay anonymous. People closest to Mindy in her life tried so hard to get her away from her father, and there was just really nothing they could do. And right when things were able to be done right before she disappeared and she finally went to authorities and told them what was happening, she vanishes a few days later, and that is just, in my opinion, not a coincidence. Unfortunately, with this case, in most people's opinions of justice, justice will never be served because Alan is deceased. But the only hope for this case officially being declared solved, by definition, is if someone is able to locate her body. Then, with today's technology, they would be able to, of course, discover how she died and test DNA and see who was responsible for her death, if somebody was actually responsible for her death, and see, obviously, if it was her father or not. But, you know, most fingers point to Alan Chambers being responsible. Her loved ones do not believe that she is just out there living somewhere else. They do believe that something did, in fact, happen to Mindy. When it comes to locations where Mindy's remains may be, nobody really has any idea. There have been locations that have popped up here and there, but they have looked in these locations and nothing has really come of it. So that is the case of Mindy Chambers, and I'm sure there's a lot of information that was not included in this video because none of us really know about that information. I have all of my information right here, about 50 pages worth, and I can't remember the last time I dove into a case this much. Her case gets very confusing, but I tried to put all the information in an order that was as easy to understand as possible. With all of that being said, I want to thank from the bottom of my heart the person that I spoke to about this case and sending me over all of the documents so I could put this video together. I hope that if anything comes out of this video, it's just more people learning about Mindy's case, because hers deserves to definitely be talked about.